On one hand, it's very neat to see a goat close up. I think it's the highlight of a lot of people's visit here, you know, because most of the time you only see goats up on cliffs and it's a mile away and they're just a white speck up there. While here, you can get 25 yards away from goats and it's an amazing experience. But is that impacting the goats? Is that impacting the goats' behavior? It's important to know. Is it taken away from the naturalness of the park? It might be.
Yeah, habituation in wildlife is basically when they become accustomed to being in close proximity to people or seek people out as a source of food or other attractant. They've lost their fear of humans, and for whatever reason they either cannot or will not act natural and forage naturally anymore, and they see humans as a source of food or mineral supplement, which is the case up at Logan Pass. They're there attracted as a looking for salt, whether that be on the sweat of backpacks or the urine along the trails, and they've just learned to accept people at close proximity to get that salt that they crave.
Some differences in behavior that we're seeing with the habituated goats versus what I call the wild goats, or the goats that are not habituated, are wild goats are a lot more skittish when they see predators. Wild goats do not bed far away from cliffs. The habituated goats are often seen far away from cliffs, not only getting salt, but also feeding and bedding and doing all sorts of behaviors away from cliffs, which is quite unusual, while the wild goats only come away from cliffs to get salt.
The mountain goat study at Logan Pass is part of the overall Going to the Sun Road Corridor Management Plan, and when we were scoping for that project, one of the topics that continually came up was human-wildlife interactions along the whole corridor, and we just thought that, you know, if we're going to do a study on that, the best place to do it would be at Logan Pass with all the people up there and the habituated mountain goats and bighorn sheep. We'd also like to get a better understanding of what's driving the interaction with the goats and the visitors, whether that's an attraction for salt and or if it's the fact that there's so many people, it's kind of a predator-free zone, and they've clued into that and they're using the people as protection. And then basically if we can then come up with some alternatives to better manage the interaction between the wildlife and the humans there that's safer for not only the wildlife but also for the visitors. We tried to explain why the goats have collars for the study, because we are doing observational data collection, but that can only get you so far in helping to tease out what we're trying to get answered here. And so we need to put collars out, and we have a VHF collar, which you actually have to go out in the ground and use a telemetry, you know, to track it down. And we also have GPS collars, which link up to a satellite and we can download the data. And what we explain to people is that we need that technology to help fine tune the data that we're getting.
And so what the collars do is they allow us to know where the goats are, how they're moving, when they're using the area, how predators influence them, because we know that people are seeing predators around here, so we can time people's observations up with predators to the goat movement. We can know when they're coming into Logan Pass and when they're leaving, and also when they die. The overall goal of the project is to really understand habituation and wildlife better, especially in the Going to Sun Road corridor, where we get 2 million visitors a year in this area, and there's going to be impacts to wildlife. How do people influence wildlife? Is it good? Is it bad? Is it neutral? Is it taken away from the naturalness of the park? National parks are supposed to be our most pristine places, and if animals are acting unnaturally, then that's taken away from that pristine nature of the parks.